reminiscing today and using the all-time, old-time goodies and all that stuff.
And to me, we have a culture surpassed by no other civilization, but we don't know anything about it.
I think you can always write something that the people will understand.
Thank God that he gave me the energy to carry out the role. But I was just playing a part for humanity, and I'm still playing a part for humanity. That's my role.
Hello all, this is Julian Butts, aka Distinguished Legacy. Thank you so much for joining us for another episode of Soundtrack to My Life, live from Humane Studios. You all know the theme, man, classic albums, classic conversation. And it wouldn't be me if I didn't have a guest here to join me today, a content extraordinaire, or someone that I look to in that space to be innovative and creative and kind of push the culture forward. So without further ado, man, I'm going to introduce Mr. Himie Freeman, man. How you doing, bro?
I'm good, man. How you?
Absolutely. I'm doing great, man. Pleasure for you to be here, bro. You're somebody whose expertise in music, I want to pick your brain and see what you think about things in that space. So I appreciate you for joining us today.
I appreciate you having me, man.
Absolutely.
I'm definitely happy to be invited to the
show. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So, like I said, man, a content guy, like that's how I was introduced to you, was the Black in America. I love that. I love everything you did with Brothers Broke. So like, could you speak on what you've been doing in the content space, and you know, even if it's your own endeavors or what you do professionally?
In the content space, well, I do a number of things. I'm an actor, writer, producer. I don't know where to start with it. I've been acting since high school. Mm-hmm. Like they had me in there, like, but I went to a very white school. Mm-hmm. And my first role was they had me in as a slave. Okay. And I was the only black guy in the play.
You're lying, right?
No, bro. Oh, shut up. I played Henry Williams in the night Thoreau went to jail. And so after that, you know, I was like, you know, let me write my own little thing. ain't got to have me in there looking crazy. So, yeah, I did. So that's how I really started getting into writing for real. Like, because mm-hmm. I wanted to also write my own content. But
yeah, you had to write your own shit.
Yeah. Now, like, the next year of school, I got to put on, like, two plays that I wrote. For my class play, so it was, I mean, it probably was not that good. And I looked back at it, but it helped me get to make my process, and then just been working ever since. And I really started taking it serious in college, doing college theater, and then when it came to doing Brothers Is Broke, mm-hmm. just me, two of my best friends came together to make a project that really came from, I'm happy it happened, because it came from a joke. You know, I just used to make people just like, my friends always ask to do something, and if I ain't really want to do it, I'm like, nah, man, bro, this is broke. And my homeboy Zach was just like, man, I think we should make that into a YouTube thing and everything like that. So, so, yeah, from there, yeah, you know, just still doing independent projects, you know, and doing my first, like, TV project and it's coming up, so just kind of work with that.
Right. So I guess for me, the reason why I think Brothers Is Broke is brilliant, because I'm one of the people that scour YouTube for like original content. You know, it's flooded with a lot of BS. Nothing's new. Nothing is expiring. So, like, to see that you had, like, an authentic connection with your friends, to see y'all try to go through different scenes and try not to laugh at each other, bro. Like, it had me, like, you could tell, like, I'm like, I wish I was on set during some of those scenes, and it was amazing, bro. So, like, I guess, for me, let me ask, like, what would be, like, a dream scenario for you as an actor, as a writer, and as a producer?
For me, a dream scenario, see, as an actor, my main thing is, like, I just want to be somebody that is playing characters that really have, like, authenticness to them in productions that really push me as an actor. Like, I don't want to be in some stuff that just, even if it's hot, like, I don't want to just be in some stuff just because, oh, I mean, it's just this project and you're doing it and the character's not interesting. Like, that's not the type of stuff for me, because, I mean, honestly, like, I feel like, really, when I hone in on my craft and do what I gotta do, I feel like I'm one of the best actors in the world when I really go ahead and do what I'm supposed to do.
So I agree.
For me, it's like, I just gotta keep pushing. So for me as an actor, that's what it is. As a writer and producer, I just wanna make content that people enjoy, along with the fact that I can also put stuff in there that people can also learn to build from. Like, I don't wanna just be, like, Brothers Is Broke, like, even though we do some comedy stuff, like, the goal is not just to be making stuff that's just funny and you don't take nothing from it, and you don't have no, like, no real life connection to it. Like, I really wanted to do stuff that people connect with. Like, I'm not, I don't know, man. As you said, it's a lot of stuff out there that people are doing. It's just like, okay, that's just simple. That
right.
Somebody just put together or right. sloppily put together. I'm not trying to be one of the people.
Right, all right. Nah, man. And I, number one, I respect that. I appreciate it. And I think that people will appreciate it over time. And that a lot of people are appreciating it now, gravitating, like, y'all getting crazy views, bro. Ain't no engine behind y'all pushing y'all. That's just, you know what I mean? That's y'all's merit, y'all's talent, and y'all's leverage. So it's gonna bode well, and we've seen in current situations where, you know, one viral video causes people to go look back at something that happened 10 years ago, and the next thing you know, that thing got a million views. Mm-hmm. So the content is there, you know what I mean? So I appreciate it. And of course, the next thing, as you all know, the endeavors is a major factor, but of course, there's also the conversation piece as it pertains to music as well. Himie is someone that is very musically inclined. Having difficult conversations with him about pros and cons, likes and dislikes, are easy because he's someone whose palette, whose musical palette, can go there. So today we're here discussing Common's classic album, Like Water from Chocolate. So when you think of Like Water from Chocolate, do you have any first memories, or do you have any either childhood memories? Like, who put you on Common? That's a real question. You're not really old enough to be listening to Common, man. So who put you on?
I don't know what put me on the Common. I think just like hearing him on tracks with maybe like Kanye and stuff, mm-hmm. and stuff like that. Like, mm-hmm. I know one track I really liked back in the day when I was younger, was Make Her Say with Kid mm-hmm. Cudi, Common, and Kanye. So, and I listened to B. I don't know what I know B was the first Common album I listened to, and that's, I mean, that's probably his best project to me. Yeah, like, absolutely. That would be his best project. But this is my favorite one, mm-hmm. and it's just like, I remember listening to it because also I used to be on like, I used to be on my nerd stuff when it comes mm-hmm. to music stuff. Like, so I used to be on like hip hop forums mm-hmm. and all that stuff. Like, so people would always be talking about these albums and stuff. So I was like, oh, I'm gonna check out this Like Water for Chocolate, because there's two albums you will hear about with Common and being Like Water for Chocolate. Right, right. So I was like, okay, I'm gonna check it out. I remember I was at like a high school football game, and I was like, I'm gonna start listening to it now. Which, Like Water for Chocolate is not really a high school football game vibe type album, but I was listening. I remember it was raining. Actually, now I'm talking about it. It was my sister's Powder Puff game. Like, she was playing in the Powder Puff thing, so I'm just sitting there like chilling, listening to it. Album, and I was like, yo, he's really going in.
Right.
And then from then on, I just kept listening to the album. Like, you just got some of my favorite songs ever on it.
Right.
Like, and I feel like when I tell people Common is in my top five favorite rappers, I'm not playing. Like,
right.
You know, some people are like, there ain't no way you sitting at the house listening to Common. Like, I'm at the house listening to Common. Like,
absolutely. So as somebody, him being in your top five, I bet you felt vindicated by him basically going viral for that recent freestyle he did.
Man, I was saying, you gotta put this in perspective, bro. That man's first album came out in 1992.
Talk about
Can I Borrow a Dollar came out in 1992. He's still rapping like this in 2021, bro.
Yes.
Like, he's different. Like, and that's just gotta be love. Now, I'm gonna be honest, that freestyle had me hyped. And I went and turned on that new Common album, that Beautiful Revolution Part 2. I ain't really like the Beautiful Revolution. It sounded like he was rapping over, like, I ain't really like the beat selection. I'm not gonna lie. And that's usually the only thing that pulled me out of certain Common albums, is whatever production he chooses to rap over.
Right.
Like, some of his stuff in the 90s, like some of the production, I'm like, I'm not the biggest fan of some of these songs because of the production he rapped over. And I think Like Water for Chocolate was the first album that he really just put it together to where every beat is nice.
Yeah.
He's rapping, he's going crazy. Like, if you look at from the top of the album, like, it's interesting the choice that he made, like with the first song, the tribute to Fela Kuti, Time Traveling. It's mm-hmm. like he starts out with like very musical, mm-hmm. and he's still snapping on that. Mm-hmm. But it's very musical, and then the next three songs with Heat, I know Heat doing it, and Cold Blooded, it's Heat, Cold Blooded, and doing it. And he just, Those are three songs where he just snapping, bro. Yeah. Like, he just rapping his ass off in three songs. Like, just letting you know, like, he's really nice like that before he gets into this now. He start getting into the more, like, artistic with the light, which is what
I was just about to say that, but that records out. The way this album is constructed, right? Because it goes from that trifecta into the light, so it automatically it changes your whole emotional palette and adjusts it for this. For me, I agree with you. The biggest, the song that stuck out for me, and then I'll let you go, was Song for a Soda. I thought it was daring. Of course, my parents are educators. They made me aware of people like your Asada Shakur's and your Fred Hamptons of the world. And before, you know, before the movie came out, before he spoke about it, and it's like, you didn't hear. These dark room topics that, like, if you didn't do your own back end research on this stuff, as black people, we wouldn't have known that these type of revolutionaries exist. And of course, him actually breaking down, me going back and reading the book for myself, and him actually breaking the entire book down into 3 minutes of a song, like, I thought that was brilliant. So for you, like, other than that trifecta, man, what are some of the songs that, you know, stick out to you? Or
songs that stick out? A Song for a Soda definitely sticks out to me, because, like, as you said, like, that's a story. I had heard a little bit about it, just because, like, me growing up, I couldn't really, my parents were strict. I couldn't play no video game, watch no TV or nothing like that during the week. So I just be like on the internet just looking at stuff just randomly. So I had read about Asada Secure on the internet and everything, but the song, like, really stuck out to me because that's me hearing it younger, like in high school. And it's pretty interesting because with my teacher actually ended up referencing it in class like 2 years later. Shout out to Mr. Graver, man.
For sure.
But because they were talking about when Common went to the White House, and some people were not happy about when Common was invited to the White House because of the song for a Soda.
Yep.
I mean, it's a special record, but I mean, the songs that stick out to me, I was on here, The Sixth Sense obviously sticks out to me. That's one of his best rap performances ever. And then it's really this run from Nod Champa to really the end of the album, but it's like Thelonious is an amazing record. Like the way it was rapping, like Dilla got off on the end of that last verse too, and the way it transitions right into Payback as a Grandmother, where he brings back the Stolen Moments series from where One Day it'll All Make Sense. Like every song really sticks out. The only song when I was younger that I kind of wasn't rocking with like that was a film called Pimp. Like, I wasn't the biggest fan of it. But I think it's just because I wasn't that much on to, like, pimp culture and stuff like that. So listening to back when I got older, I was like, yo, this is a funny ass record, the way him and MC like going back and forth saying they pimp shit. Right. Like, it's fine.
I also appreciated the heavy feature work he got from Slum Village. As we all, that's a very much underappreciated entity in the hip hop community. It's good to hear them sporadically on other people's track. I would have loved to have more music from them because I just feel like they would just that pairing just works. So man, I really appreciate it. On the outro, what would be a song that you would like to play?
Song I would like to play off here, I would say Nod Champa that's a special record to me. Like, it's probably one of my most played songs. Like, it's just, I love the production and the raps on there. It's crazy, and I just love the hook, it's everything. Like, I love the way it's structured. Like, I feel like it's definitely a special record. Aphrodisiac for the World. I love that record. So
okay.
I think that's one I want right now.
Well, let's do Aphrodisiac for the World.
Okay.
Let's see if we can see the coon. You take a look at this one and see if it's on there. I don't know if I got the A side or the B side.
It's on here.
It's on that one?
Yep. I might want to switch up. I might want that Sixth Sense now. Okay. I don't know.
We can do Sixth Sense as the first song, so we should be able to get that one.
The revolution is here. Yeah, it's Common Sense with DJ Premier. We gon' help y'all see clear. It's real hip hop music from the soul, y'all. Yeah, check it. Yeah. The perseverance of a rebel, I drop heavier levels, it's unseen or heard. A king with words, can't knock the hustle, but I've seen street dreams deferred. Dark spots in my mind where the scene occurred. Some say I'm too deep, I'm in too deep to sleep. Through me, Muhammad will forever speak. Greet brothers with handshakes on ghetto landscapes, where a man is determined by how much a man makes. Cop cognacs and spit old raps with young cats with cigarettes in their ear. Nigger rich state.
Hugh.